This week on Wealth Track, two outstanding personal finance journalists, Jonathan Clements and Jason Zweig, tackle the biggest financial challenges facing Americans and how to overcome them. Retirement income, market volatility, and getting good financial advice are next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fair Home Foundation. Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. A constant theme on Wealth Track in recent years is how income-starved most investors are feeling. According to recent financial well-being surveys of American workers done for Principal Financial Services Group, 63% of employees are concerned about having a financially comfortable retirement. They will need income. And 36% fear the rising cost of inflation, which of course cuts into their purchasing power big time. These fears are justified. In just the last decade, the yield on high-quality short-term bonds has dropped from 2.4% to under 1%. On government bonds, including treasuries and agency bonds, yields fell from above 3% to under 2%. And investment-grade corporate bond yields have fallen from 4.5% to close to 3%. And even with relatively benign inflation, the loss of purchasing power over the last decade has been significant. With annual inflation averaging under 2.5%, the cumulative effect is a loss of about 25% in purchasing power over the last 10 years. These are just two of the major financial challenges facing American citizens, and they are concerns this week's two guests have researched and written about extensively. I am delighted to have two of the best personal finance journalists in the country with us. Both have been WealthTrack guests since the early days. They are columnists and authors, and both are now working at the Wall Street Journal. Jonathan Clements recently returned to the paper to write a weekly column for the Wall Street Journal Sunday, having spent the last 5 years as director of financial education for Citigroup's U.S. wealth management business. And before that, Jonathan spent 18 years at the Journal, where he wrote its Getting Going personal finance column. He is the author of several books, including The Little Book of Main Street Money. Jason Zweig has written the Intelligent Investor column for the Journal since 2008. It is considered to be a must-read by many WealthTrack guests. Prior to that, he was a senior writer for Money Magazine. He is particularly well-known for his research on the neuroscience of investing and how the brain can sabotage financial judgment. He wrote one of the first books on the subject titled Your Money and Your Brain. He is also the author of The Little Book of Safe Money. I began the interview by asking them about one of the greatest challenges facing Americans, finding enough income for retirement.
Well, you know what the big story is. You go back to 1981, we had the 10-year Treasury note yielding almost 16%. That rolled all the way down to July 2012. We hit 1.4%. From there, we bounced up a little bit. We got pretty close to 3%, but still, we are at a very low level. And for a lot of retirees, it's like, I can't live off 3%. Where am I going to turn for income? And my first suggestion is you should exploit the one advantage that we all have. We're going to die. And the way you exploit that advantage is, one, you can buy an annuity that'll pay you lifetime income. And the longer you wait to buy that annuity, the more income you're going to get. What I'm talking about here is like plain vanilla immediate fixed annuities. Mm-hmm. And second, if you're interested in the annuity idea, the best annuity out there is Social Security. So if you want that lifetime stream of income, what you should think about doing is delaying Social Security for as long as possible, preferably to as late as age 70. If you do that, delayed till age 70, the amount of income you're going to get will be more than 70% higher than what you would have got at age 62. And on top of that, there'll also be inflation increases.
Jason, would you agree with Jonathan, number one, on how we've started this conversation? And Social Security and a fixed immediate annuity would be two things that you should really look seriously at?
Well, definitely. I mean, I think one thing that retirees and near retirees tend to forget is they think of Social Security as a source of income, which right. of course it is. They don't really think of it as an asset. Mm-hmm. And one of the useful things, I don't know what multiplier you would use, Jonathan, but maybe as a rough rule of thumb, something like 30, right? You would say, well, if I get $1,000 a month from Social Security, that's $12,000 a year. So that's sort of the equivalent of owning maybe $350,000, $400,000 worth of bonds. That's a very rough rule of thumb.
No, but that's a really good way to look at it.
And so a lot of people feel going into retirement, you know, I need to own a ton of bonds because I need all to generate all this income. But you already own some bonds in the form of the Social Security that's being generated for you. So you should factor that into your thinking.
I'm richer than I thought.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I guess the flip side to the annuity argument is that Americans need to be careful of annuities that are pushed really hard by people with what I think we could call sort of obscene incentives to sell them. Not the immediate income annuities that Jonathan's talking about, but a lot of other fixed annuities carry commissions of, you know, 9-10% or higher. And you should really ask yourself, if somebody has to get paid 10% to sell this to me, how good could it be? When, you know, much lower cost alternatives are available, you probably don't want to buy the thing that somebody wouldn't be willing to sell you if he wasn't going to be able to earn 10% to do it.
The biggest risk in retirement is that you're going to outlive your savings. And so what you want are lifetime streams of income. And you can get that from Social Security, and you can get that from an immediate fixed annuity. So what I would suggest people do is, if you're going to spend down your savings at any point, spend them down early in retirement so that you can put off buying that immediate fixed annuity, and you can put off claiming Social Security. And that way, you're going to get that larger stream of lifetime income. And you'll say to me, well, okay, but what if I do die young? Well, it's not a decision you'll live to regret.
You can buy an immediate fixed annuity at any time, and you're saying that the later you wait, the longer you wait, the later you buy it, the better off, and the more money you're going to get for whatever investment you make in it.
That's correct.
There are other people who have advised us on WealthTrack is to stagger your purchases of these annuities. For instance, to buy, I don't know, $50,000 now, and then in another 5 years when interest rates are higher, buy another $50,000. I mean, what about that kind of strategy
assuming,
number one, you're going to get more money, but also you're assuming that interest rates will be higher than they are now, which are still pretty much near record lows.
Yeah, well, it's hard to forecast interest rates. But we do know, and Jason's much more adept about talking about this than I am, investors tend to have this aversion to regret. And so people don't want to make that big annuity purchase all at once. So if you stagger it over time, what you do is you, at least in your head, you know, reduce the risk that you're going to make the big annuity purchase and then keel over and die. Right, Jason?
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, part of what investors always need to diversify is the risks in their own behavior. So one risk is people are averse to annuities because they don't like shelling out the lump sum up front and to get dribs and drabs over time. So what you can do is you can say, well, I'm a little uncomfortable shelling all this money out today that I'm going to receive over the next 10, 20, or 30 years. So maybe I'll do some today, some 1 year from now, or 5 years from now. The trick to that is you have to make a pre-commitment to it. And
how so? Just psychologically you do? Or
no, if you make a psychological commitment, you've just committed yourself to fail. Because your willpower alone will never be sufficient to make sure you follow through on your intentions. What I would suggest is that you use technology that's widely available to make it work for you. There are various websites that enable you to commit to goals. One is called stick.com, which is kind of has some nice techniques for making sure you live up to a commitment.
But that you stick to your commitment? Is that where that comes
that's
from?
That's the idea. And if you simply say to yourself, okay, I'll buy some now, and then I'll buy some 5 years from now. Well, 5 years from now, first of all, you won't remember you have a commitment. But if you do remember, you'll say, oh, well, yeah, I was supposed to do it today, but after all, I made the commitment 5 years ago, so what the heck, I'll wait till tomorrow. And then you'll die.
Are there rules as far as how much you should pay in commissions? That's another scary part, because people are afraid of annuities because they sound complicated.
In terms of the immediate fixed annuities, I mean, you definitely want an insurance company with a top rating. But just one alternative that people might want to consider, given this issue of aversion to regret, is there's a little publicized type of annuity, but is seriously worth considering, is what's called a charitable gift annuity, which is if you have a favorite charity, call them up and see if they offer a charitable gift annuity. Mm-hmm. And it's very similar to an immediate fixed annuity. The income is going to be somewhat less because you are making a charitable gift. But the good news is, if you do indeed go under the bus 2 years from now, it's not the big nasty insurance company that benefits from your early demise. Instead, it's going to be the charity that you are looking to support.
Interesting that neither of you have yet mentioned, maybe because you haven't had a chance to, dividend-paying stocks, which has been a huge topic of conversation on WealthTrack over the last several years. And obviously, bonds with interest rates starting to come up. Where do those factor into your search for income?
Well, I'll take the dividends first. I think dividend-paying stocks are a great source of income in the stock portion of your portfolio. The problem arises when people come to think of them as bond equivalents. And there are a lot of financial advisors and stockbrokers out there who've encouraged people to do just that.
There are bond investors, mutual fund investors, correct, investing in stocks now.
That's correct. The problem will arise if we get a replay of the financial crisis. In 2008 and 2009, dozens of high dividend paying stocks lost, at least 50% of their value in a matter of months. These things are not the equivalents of bonds. Treasury bonds went up in 2008. A lot of investment-grade corporate bonds went up in 2008 and 2009. Dividend-paying stocks went down. They went down like rocks. And that doesn't mean that you shouldn't own them. It doesn't mean that they don't provide income. It does mean that you should own them in the risk-taking part of your portfolio, along with your other stocks. You should not think of them as bond alternatives, bond substitutes, bond equivalents, bond-like. They're stocks, mm-hmm. and they're risky.
They're just income-producing stocks.
Exactly.
So what you sort of follow on from what Jason is saying, I mean, I'm a big fan of dividend-paying stocks, but if you're a retiree and you're structuring your portfolio, what you want to think about is, okay, supposing we did get another 2008, where are you going to go for income? Because even if you've got a set of stocks that are delivering you 3% income, you're probably going to need a little bit more than that from your stocks. So what are you going to do? And the solution is really pretty straightforward. When you look at your portfolio, there's that growth portion where you might have your dividend-paying stocks, but then you probably want to set aside a chunk of money in CDs, short-term bonds that are going to cover, say, your next 5 years of portfolio withdrawals from the portfolio side. So you say, okay, I need $20,000 a year from my portfolio in each of the next 5 years. Take $100,000, 5 years worth of income, and stick it in CDs and short-term bonds. So you know that whatever happens to the stock market over the next 5 years, you're going to be set. That then frees you up to be more aggressive with the rest of your portfolio.
Even though you're not going to get much income from any of those things right now.
It's true, but you also are not running the risk that you're going to wake up tomorrow and find out the S&P 500 has just dropped 57%.
That's another huge challenge for Americans is the markets and market volatility. So how do we handle that challenge?
The way I would advise people to think about it is to ignore the overall question of whether stocks are slightly overvalued or wildly overvalued, and instead ask yourself, what did I do in 2008 and 2009 when the stock market dropped 57% or so in 12 to 18 months, what did I do? If you sold when stocks went down, then yes, stocks are insanely overvalued right now mm-hmm. for you, because when they drop again, you'll sell again.
Mm-hmm. And you will lose big time again.
You'll probably lose even more than you did the last time, because you'll kick yourself twice as hard for being in it when you had a hunch you should be out. So if that's your experience, then you need to be very careful about repeating it.
How does one cope with the market volatility and the potential that you could lose 40% of your money at any given time?
Well, I don't want to sound like I'm parroting what Jason is saying, though, they're worse people to parrot. but you know, if you're sitting there today and saying, you know, which way is the stock market headed? Because I want to know whether I should buy or not. You know, what I would say to you is, you know, if you ask a stupid question, you'll get a stupid answer. Right? If your decision to buy today depends on where the market is going next month or next year, you're already toast. You know, nobody can forecast the stock market return. You can't forecast the market's direction. Jason can't forecast the market's direction, and I most certainly can't forecast the market's direction. So you have to find some other basis on which to make your decision. And the thing that you can control is risk. And it's not just how much risk you take in your portfolio, but also thinking about how much risk you can personally take. I mean, how are you going to react when the market goes down? How many people really were buying in early 2009? I mean, I look back and I say that was probably the greatest buying opportunity of my adult lifetime. Mm-hmm. And so many people missed it.
Well, there's one other point I'd like to make, Consuelo, and that is if you think about what people say about Las Vegas, right, that there's only two kinds of people who leave, you know, losers and liars. I mean, so many American investors now are looking back at the financial crisis and deluding themselves into thinking they stayed put, they bought more when stocks or non-US government bonds dropped in value. And people are looking back, and there's sort of, or that when they look in the mirror, they see Warren Buffett looking back at them. And he wasn't there for them. The reason it was a panic was because people were panicking. And you can't lie to yourself about that. And the single most useful exercise any investor can do is sit down with your five-year-old account statements and look at what happened to the value of your account. And look at what you did in response. And if you have a financial advisor, you really want to look back at the decisions that financial advisor made with you or for you and see whether in hindsight they were wise. And that's a much more useful way to assess the risk of the stock market for you today than trying to figure out whether the stock market is overpriced.
I'm looking at you two, of course, for financial advice because you two are top personal finance journalists. And Jonathan, where do we go for good financial advice? That is a question I get on WealthTrack all the time.
When you think about financial advice, there are really two issues that you need to address or you need to be concerned about. One is the cost, because the cost of getting financial advice can be huge. And second, you need to worry about the chance for mischief. Because the fact is, you know, we're dealing with, you know, your future, your financial future, how you're going to pay for retirement. And just as, you know, you can't afford to, you know, panic at the bottom of the market in early 2009 and get out of stocks at the worst possible time, similarly, you know, you can't hitch your wagon to some financial advisor who's then going to take you to the cleaners. So you need to worry about the cost and you need to worry about mischief. And I would say that, you know, if those are your two concerns, the place where you should be most concerned is when you're paying somebody in the form of commissions. I mean, that is the point when it becomes most treacherous because all the financial incentives are wrong. The financial advisor has an incentive to get you to buy and sell, preferably to buy and sell stuff that has high commissions, and that may not be the best thing for you to do. I'm not saying that paying commissions isn't necessarily the cheapest way to invest. It can actually be a relatively low-cost way for people to invest if it's done properly, even with a financial advisor, but the chance of mischief is enormous, and that's why I would tend to be leery of commission arrangements.
Except we have an issue, Jason has an issue, with fee-based.
Yeah, I mean, one of the problems is we've moved in this country to a situation where many financial advisors charge their clients on the basis of the assets under management.
Yes. So, and normally it's what, 1% of assets under management?
1% is certainly the most typical arrangement. So, you know, if you have, say, $500,000 or less, you might pay somewhere between 1.5% and 2% a year to have your money managed, but also to get financial advice. And that's really the problem I have with it. I mean, if you go to your lawyer, you pay for legal advice. And you pay for it
by the hour, usually.
By the hour, and you write a check for the legal advice.
Yes.
You don't pay your lawyer a percentage of your net worth for his legal advice. When you go to a financial advisor, you may or may not get real financial advice. That's a different conversation. But you're going to pay for it as a percentage of your assets, even if what the financial advisor is doing for you has not that much to do with managing your money. You may want estate planning, tax planning, retirement planning, all of which are more or less independent of the amount of money you happen to have. And to pay, you know, 1% of $100,000, $500,000, $1 million, $10 million, but to be getting similar advice in every case seems kind of bizarre.
What's the alternative?
Well, there's a few things you can do. First of all, for people who have relatively modest sums of money, this structure, this fee-only financial planning, may be pretty cost-effective. It's wealthier people who can end up paying a lot more than they might otherwise need to. And those people should consider looking for a financial advisor who charges hourly fees or an annual retainer or charges effectively by the job and says, well, for what you're asking me to do, I would charge you, you know, $5,000.
One investment for a long-term diversified portfolio, I ask every guest that. Jonathan Clements, what would it be? What would you have us do or invest in?
We talked earlier about dividend-paying stocks, but if you're going to invest in dividend-paying stocks, you really want to be diversifying internationally. Everybody thinks about U.S. stocks. So there are a number of relatively low-cost ETFs out there that focus on international dividend-paying stocks. One you might want to look at is Wisdom Tree DFEA Equity Income Fund. I think the ticker symbol is DTH, getting a yield pretty close to 3%. Expenses are maybe moderately higher than I would like, 0.58%. Nonetheless, you are getting that international diversification, though with it comes currency risk. But that, you know, anybody who's building a stock portfolio should be diversified internationally.
What would yours be, Jason?
I think, Consuelo, I would suggest either TIPS, Treasury Inflation Protected Securities.
Even though there's no inflation around.
There's no inflation around, and we'll get to that in a second. Or I-bonds, which are a kind of savings bond issued by the government that also offers an inflation-protected interest payment. I-bonds are only available in small denominations, although you can game it a little by buying in the names of all your family members and things like that. Inflation is quiet right now, but what TIPS and other inflation-protected securities offer you is insurance against unexpected inflation. If we were all talking about, oh, inflation is picking up, then that would probably be the time not to buy inflation-protected securities because everyone would be expecting inflation. They protect you against inflation surprise, which is the thing you really need protection against. So I'm a fan of those and somewhat more so than I would have been a year ago based on the pricing.
And spoken as a value investor as well,
yeah,
I will
exactly.
add. So Jason Zweig, so great to have you here. Jonathan Clements, the two of you together now both once again at the Wall Street Journal as columnists. Thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week, I want to pick up on Jason Zweig's brilliant observation that your Social Security benefits are the equivalent of having a substantial and high-quality portfolio of bonds. So this week's action point is treat your Social Security as a bond holding. It does generate regular and reliable income no matter what the market climate. And to duplicate it, you would need a large position in bonds. For instance, 10-year Treasury bonds have been yielding around 3%. If you are getting $21,000 of Social Security income a year, that is the equivalent of having a $700,000 portfolio of 10-year Treasuries. $9,000 in Social Security income would take a $300,000 Treasury portfolio. It is definitely worth getting the most out of this asset. Social Security guru Mary Beth Franklin recommends the website socialsecuritysolutions.com, where you can get three levels of personalized reports for modest fees. Well, next week, we're going to sit down with financial thought leader and entrepreneur Rob Arnott, who is shaking up the money management industry with his fundamental index approach. Has he created a better mousetrap? To hear more of our interview with Jonathan Clements and Jason Zweig, go to the extra feature on our website, And also, we are introducing a new feature on our website. It's called WealthTrack Women. Investment pros who specialize in advising women clients will answer questions vital to their financial health. And before we leave you, we have a big personnel change to tell you about at WealthTrack. Our show producer, Teresa Abate, who started with us almost at the beginning 8 years ago as an associate producer, and through her phenomenal skills and talent became WealthTrack's producer, is leaving us to pursue new dreams. The sky is the limit for Teresa, and we can't wait to see what she decides to conquer next. We will really miss her. In the meantime, have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairhome Foundation.